to see them?
No, I don't.
Right, okay. Right, fine. Okay. Did you actually mind dressing up as a fairy godmother?
Well, not really, because I was an actor before I came to the BBC, and I think the great joy for any artiste in any form is to see people laugh and to give them enjoyment. So, no, not at all. Not at all.
There wasn't any stick when you got back from your colleagues.
Oh, well, you always get ribbed by your colleagues, don't you? You know, your theatrical tart and things like that, which is a lovely expression in its own way, so even that didn't bother me, no, no.
You didn't object?
No, 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 no. I think we're all very broad-minded in the business.
How did you find these people who blew on their arms, who kept miles of verges clean?
Well, I always used to keep my eyes open for unusual stories, because I think they're one of the things that people like to see. I mean, if you'd been working all day in a cymbal-spinning factory or putting rivets in egg poachers, you know, you want to come home at night, and once you've seen the news, then you want to be entertained and possibly slightly titillated as well. So I used to keep my eyes open. I used to ask friends if they knew anybody odd, or they bumped into anybody in the local boozer, the Frog and Nightgown, if anybody unusual had been in there. And the Pig's Trotters, actually, I was standing on a remote country airfield in the depths of winter, and they had a little Nissen Block-type gents' loo there. And I... just a two-stander, you know, double faucet. And I heard this beautiful, almost symphonic trumpet coming out of it, you see, amid the gale. And I went in, and there was somebody there playing, but without an instrument, just doing it with his lips. And I said, that's absolutely fantastic. Love to have you on a show. Can you come in? And he said, oh, I got two friends who do it as well, you see. So we got them together, and they really were very good. They sounded like the real thing, everything from symphonic marches to Berlioz, you know. I often thought the sound was a combination between a blowback on an S-bend and something slightly more ethereal, probably much admired by some of the more avant-garde of the French poets. But anyway, we always just have a lovely laugh about this. Got picked up by various shows, and... We did so many generation game and everything like that. And from my point of view, it was, and I know from the Trotters as well, it was a lovely thrill to be able to walk such a big stage at the television theatre, where you're backed by a 35-piece orchestra, harps, double percussion and everything like that. And it was something that I will always remember, certainly.
How did you meet the gardening superstars?
Do you know, it's one of those things I really can't remember. I think the thing is, you do thousands and thousands of interviews. And what you must remember, John, is that in those days, all of us, all the reporters, interviewers, worked in both media mediums. We were both wireless reporters and presenters and interviewers, and we also did television as well. So how I came across them, I honestly can't say, but quite a lucky little find, I'd have thought.
How do you think it's changed?
I think it's rather sad. I think television has changed. It's become too newsy. I know the young people wouldn't agree with this who run television these days. I think it's become too newsy with too many talking heads, councillors, officials, reports on water, this, that and the other. People have got a lot of problems, and once they've seen the basics of that, they want to come home and be entertained. And I think there's still room for humour, laugh, belly laughs and everything like that. And I can't call them cranks really, but these eccentrics, they are still around. They are still around doing mad things, fortunately.
Perhaps waiting for you to come along.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, I don't think I've lost the art, if it is not.
what's the most sort of eccentric thing you've ever done or eccentric person you've ever met?
I bumped into a woman one day, and I think she was in charge of all the police switchboards. And her hobby was tickling pigs. And she'd been all over the country tickling pigs, and she used to carry a pig-tickling stick in a little case, attaché case with her. A delightful person, and we filmed her tickling various breeds of pigs. And I said, Miss Snodgrass, why do you tickle pigs? I said, it's an odd thing. She said, well, darling, she said, everybody goes around tickling cats and Alsatians and Dalmatians and everything like that, but nobody tickles pigs. Why should they be left out of it? So, you know, she spent a fortune going around the country, even on Lim Airport in Kent, I think she'd been tickling landrace pigs, yes.
She didn't have a favourite breed?
No, there was no favouritism at all. You know, short backs, long backs, droopy ears, hairy, you know, wire-coated, everything. They all got their fair share.
What is the most peculiar thing you've ever done for television?
Oh, God. If anybody ever talks to you about television, that's one thing they always ask you, isn't it? I suppose it was, I can't swim, and it was being thrown into the 6-footy deep end of a swimming pool, which contained two performing dolphins. So I thought, well, God, I can't swim for a start. So, you know, and they said, well, there's a lifesaver on the side. If you've been down more than about 30 seconds, he'll come in and get you. And then before I went in, the trainer said, I must warn you. He said, the male dolphin to the female dolphin is very protective and supportive. And he said, if you get anywhere near her, it'll come at you through the water and it'll head straight for your liver at about 45 knots. He said, so do be careful. So those are some of the things we have to put up with.
Did it?
No, it didn't, fortunately. Otherwise, you and I would not be sitting here at this moment.
Fine. Lovely. Right.
Took his shirt in,
Singe.
I didn't want
it
too
scruffy. Right.
Okay.
We'll just do this two-shot, then. Which is, as you know, and where do you get the high-quality fabrics from? Presumably it's a little man in German Street who knocks them up for you.
Except he's Polish.
Polish man in German Street. In Jaminski Street. Mm. Yes, very nice too. Mm. Lovely. And that should be okay. And afterwards we'll just talk about cleaning budgery girls.
Yes.
Yes. Right, do you want to go into that? I get out of the way?
That's all right.
Oh, right, okay. Right, tell me about...
Well, people who have hobbies, even some of the things they have to do for that hobby are very, very strange. If you exhibit canaries, you have to shampoo your canary with a little shaving brush and foam and everything like that and be very delicate with them. And I said to this chap, well, what about all this water? And he said, well, if they get the water down them, you have to revive them with mouth-to-mouth, except in that, I suppose, it'd be mouth-to-beak, wouldn't it? But that's that. And I always remember being at the Royal Show one day, and there was a Farmer's Weekly poster outside, which said, revive your piglets with a kiss of life. So I suppose that's mouth-to-snout, isn't it? But, you know, it is about, isn't it?
The property department is a jungle of paraphernalia. In it, you can find everything from a stuffed alligator to a Victorian dentist chair, a baby's gas mask, or Cleopatra's throne. Then, at the top of the stairs, you come to the costume department, filled with row upon row of colourful silks and satins, gauzes and lace. You walk under a rack hanging with church vestments, and then move on to the colourful tunics of the cavalry. The whole atmosphere of the place seems to have a strange effect on the people who spend all their working time here. They dress up themselves, and it's quite surprising who you bump into. It's amazing the amount of costumes which are sent from the rep here to all parts of the country. And perhaps you didn't realise that in Birmingham alone there are 300 amateur dramatic societies who use the rep's hire service. Like the theatre itself, the whole place has an atmosphere of magic about it, and you can almost feel yourself being carried away into the world of pantomime.
My good lord, I bring you news from the land of the ice and snow, from continents as yet uncharted. Believe you me, that's difficult with the price of postage these days. But I, the good fairy, with one wave of my magic wand, will grant your every wish. Thank goodness for that. I thought the batteries were flat. Music, maestro, please. What's the most unusual thing you've ever been asked for?
Oh, yes. Now, let me think. An 8-foot-high, solid stone statue of Romulus and Remus. Obviously, we couldn't do that, because the wolf had had it.
So what did you tell the caller?
Well, I said, I'm sorry, dear, but we just can't do that, and that was it. I sent around to the local stonemason to see if he can knock one off quickly.
Well, there we are. Like all good things, our visit has to come to an end. The curtain comes down on yet another show. So, with a few of my newfound friends, I'll make my way back to the studios.
There's no business-like show, business-like no business I know.
You get word before the show has started that your favorite uncle died at dawn. And top of that, your pa and ma have parted. You're broken-hearted, but you go on.
There's no people like show. People, they smile when they are low.
Even with a turkey that you know